There are some reports coming out of Iraq that ISIS is on the run. Pretty good news. AFP reports, quote, after the U.S.-led coalition paved the way with some 50 airstrikes, around 8,000 Kurdish Peshmerga fighters reclaimed some 270 square miles in the Zumar and Sinjar regions in 2 days. Late Thursday, they reached Mount Sinjar, where thousands of fighters and civilians from the Yazidi minority had been besieged for months. The Peshmerga have liberated around 70% of the areas around Mount Sinjar. So we're seeing some pretty big gains. So they go on to say this, quote, among those killed was Abu Muslim al-Turkmani, who was Baghdadi's deputy in charge of Iraq. So basically what that means is the number two or number three guy in ISIS is done, is killed, and it's confirmed. But here's why I think this story is really, really interesting. Because it's a teaching moment. And we spoke about this months ago. I brought this up months ago. The Kurds are gonna fight ISIS because ISIS wants to kill the Kurds. Iranian Shiites are definitely gonna fight ISIS, and they are, because they're Shiite, and ISIS is Sunni, and the Sunnis want to wipe out the Shiites, or I should say the Sunni extremists in ISIS want to wipe out the Shiites. And also fighting ISIS is Assad's Syrian army. Now, they're tired, and they've been fighting for such a long time in a war against the FSA, which are the rebels in Syria, and against ISIS, and against al-Nusra Front, which is another jihadist group. So they're tired, but they're continuing the fight. So essentially, you have ISIS surrounded. They're fighting the Kurds, they're fighting the Shiites from Iran, and they're fighting the Shiites in Syria, the Shiite, Alawite-aligned people in Syria. So this is why somebody like me and some others get so angry when President Obama and the government in this country, they're like excited to get involved in this conflict. And they're talking about sending more ground troops and doing this and doing that. I mean, they fucking switched sides within a year's time frame. At first they were talking about we need to attack Assad, we need to get rid of Assad because he's a brutal dictator and he's gassing the civilian population. And then within a year they totally flipped their position. They said now we need to get involved to fight the people who were fighting Assad, who we were going to be allies with a year ago. So it's almost, they're looking for an angle to get into the conflict. But again, if you look at the situation on the ground as it exists, it is going to resolve itself. Now, of course, I don't want any civilians dying under any circumstance. But if there's a war going on in another country between two groups of people that have nothing to do with Dave in Iowa and Steve in Alabama, why should we get involved? I mean, that's the equivalent of you. Let's say you are driving down a main road at night in the city, let's say, and you look to your left and you see that there's a bar fight going on. There's a bar fight going on. There's a crowd of people around them. You see it. You're just driving by in your car. The light turns green. You're like, and you just keep going, right? I mean, what are you going to do? What are you going to park your car when there's no fucking parking spaces, right? Get out of your car and go do something to jump in on one person's side? When last week you wanted to jump in on the other person's side also, to draw the analogy with Syria? And also, there's all these other people surrounding them. They're closer. Why wouldn't they do something in the situation? See, look, if you break it down to a human perspective and like it's your everyday life, you start to realize how absurd U.S. foreign policy is. Now, don't get me wrong. Are there some circumstances where you can make an argument for humanitarian intervention if and only if you go through the proper legal channels? Absolutely. Look, I'm a fairly committed non-interventionist, but that doesn't mean that I'm also not open to democratic opinion. So that means that, let's say, you have the situation like we had in Iraq with the Yazidis on Mount Sinjar, where they were caught there. There were civilians and women and children, and there was hardcore evidence there was a flat-out slaughter going on. It was a genocide. ISIS was killing these people in huge, gigantic, open graves. So with a situation like that, or with a situation like we've seen in the Congo, with a situation like we've seen elsewhere in the world, where there's one side that's essentially pure right and one side that's pure wrong, I'm still a non-interventionist at heart, and I only think we should use U.S. military force when there's a direct threat of violence against the nation. But I'm open to the idea that you go to the U.N. and then the U.N. Can approve, you know, limited drone strikes to help the situation. Both the U.S. and our international allies do it. We do it together. So it's one nation among nations, not one nation above nations. And you just have to go through the U.N., you have to go through NATO, and you have to get approval through Congress, because Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution is crystal clear that Congress needs to approve war. The president can't do it himself. And that is an act of war if you get involved in that situation, even if it's just a one-week drone campaign. So I'm not a hardcore ideologue where I have a conviction that is unshakable in all circumstances. I'm pragmatic. I'm open to logical argument and reasonable disagreement and aspects where we deviate from what is otherwise a principle. But you have to do it legally, you have to do it properly, you have to go through the right channels, and you have to do it internationally together. And that, to me, appears to be the situation that happened in Syria and Iraq, and what's the best solution to the situation. Also, might I add, remember, I'm going to repeat this. They said, quote, after the U.S.-led coalition paved the way with some 50 airstrikes, that's when the 8,000 Kurdish Peshmerga beat back ISIS. They didn't say after U.S. airstrikes. If it was just the U.S., they would have said it like that. After U.S. airstrikes, the Kurdish Peshmerga advanced. No, after the U.S.-led coalition. So that means us and every other country, and there's a bunch of countries right now that are involved in the situation. So again, the best way, if you want to do an intervention, which you should do as rare can be, but when you do an intervention, do it together, go through the proper legal channels, and make it a defined mission, and then you'll get success. But the most important point to remember is, most fighting situations, you're going to have people involved in the fight to sort out the problem on their own, and you don't need to get involved. And then I come full circle back to my point about the bar fight.